sisters, brothers, non-binary cousins. We are gathered here today to talk about the origins of MCC, the Metropolitan Community Church, founded by Reverend Troy Perry. It resided for a time between 1996 to 2008 at 8714 Santa Monica Boulevard. In the beginning, or in this case, the 1960s, Perry had been forced out of his ministerial calling due to his homosexuality. Perry followed the call to go west, working for several years in a department store and serving in the military. Then, like many homosexuals at the time, he experienced an undercover vice squad police raid. Oh, let us pray. August 1968. Troy Perry was present when two men, Tony Valdez and Bill Hastings, were arrested during a police raid at a bar called The Patch in Wilmington, near Long Beach. The bar's owner, Lee Glaze, organized a group of some two dozen demonstrators to descend upon the police station, armed with bouquets from a bar patron's floral shop. They staged an early morning flower power protest demanding the release of those arrested during the Patch raid. And after 6 hours of gladiolas, daisies, carnations, roses, the cops let the people go. Hallelujah! That event sparked Perry to stop worrying about fitting gays into the established church and instead start building a church for all of us who are outcasts. He started small. In his living room in Highland Park, he advertised in a new local gay newspaper, The Advocate. And in time, the Metropolitan Community Church grew and grew, literally outgrowing building after building with its popularity. The MCC Church now exists in some 20 different countries with over 40,000 members. Can I get an amen? Can I get an old woman?
Troy Perry didn't just build his own church. He welcomed many expressions of spirituality. Pagan witches, looking for meeting space, formed the Susan B. Anthony Coven. So many Jewish people came to MCC, Perry encouraged them to form their own temple. And this began Beth Chaim Chadashim, making its own history as the first LGBTQ synagogue. Perry encouraged the formation of Unity Fellowship Church, the first LGBTQ African American church, founded by Carl Bean, soon Archbishop Carl Bean. Where there's flesh, there's spirit. Ah men, ah women, ah guys and gals and non-binary pals.
Hey, can we just have a moment of remembrance for West Hollywood's spirited lesbians and all the places that no longer exist for us to go and socialize? Girls just want to have fun, but there aren't as many options as there ought to be these days. For much of the 70s to 80s, there was a booming lesbian disco called Peanuts at 7969 Santa Monica Boulevard. Supposedly, a butch door woman named Mel with a big blonde pompadour stood outside making sure that predatory straight men didn't come and crash the place and try to pick up on the women. Drag queens were hired by the management to hit on obnoxious straight guys and scare them away. Oh, honey. Oh. Disco. A popular landmark for lesbians in West Hollywood was a place called the Normandy Room, and it was opened in 1993 by a straight guy. It was never intended to be a lesbian bar. He wanted it to be a place where anybody could go and feel safe. So eventually, with not many other places to go, lesbians started flocking there, and it became known as the Norm. Oh, the Palms. I mean, the Palms was there for over 40 years.
at 8572 Santa Monica Boulevard. It was a place that many lesbians frequented and people who were trying to make their mark in the entertainment industry. They were glamorous. I mean, they said that people like Melissa Etheridge, Katie Lang, Ellen DeGeneres, Sky Palkowitz, and even Jim Morrison. Wait a second, was Jim Morrison a lesbian? These were people that frequented the Palms. And as the lesbian clientele dwindled down, it became known for its festive transgender nights. This was the coolest venue in West Hollywood, and now it's gone.
Oh, but then there's Girl Bar. Down on Robertson Boulevard, across from West Hollywood Park, known as the birthplace of the lipstick lesbian. But nothing comes into being fully formed. This bar existed for many decades as the grounds for stomping butches and flitting femmes. By the late 1970s, the plaid flannel crowd began to give way to a growing number of women who actually didn't mind getting called girls and started showing up looking Hollywoody. Silk blouses, gold chains, those oh so 70s designer jeans. Lady-loving ladies with these fashion tastes became known as lipstick lesbians. There were those who considered it politically incorrect. Of course, there's still a lot of debate as we figure out the fullness of the queer spectrum.
But bars don't do it for everybody. Coffee houses provide good places for a caffeinated culture to commune. Little Frida's was West Hollywood's premier lesbian hangout in the 1990s before that megalithic mermaid took over every corner. Originally located at 8545 and later 8730 Santa Monica Boulevard, Little Frida's was the location that Katie Lang sang at. Featured in the TV sitcom Ellen's The Puppy episode, infamous for being when the DeGeneres came out on national television. The venue held numerous special events like the comedy showcase, Women with Balls, and All Women's Motorcycle Parking Lot Sale. Many folks lament its disappearance from the landscape. It foamed lattes while stirring the hearts of many couples who proclaimed that their love began there.
Ooh, Little Frida's lesbian coffee house. You stir foaming lattes while stirring the hearts of many lesbian couples. Ooh, Little Frida.
Everyone should be free to dress as they like, and sometimes girls just want to have fun.
I remember Patty behind the bar at the Palms and Victor. We even ran a play there for a number of years called Joni and Gina's Lesbian Wedding, in which I was singing and dancing.
An undercover! Vice Squad! Police raid! Oh, let us pray!
May you be blessed. May you be blessed. May you all be blessed.